Good morning. Welcome to Platt Hill Nursery. I'm glad you're here to join us. This morning, I am on the topic of pet safe plants. I'm joined this morning by Dr. Mary Benz. She joins us from Randall Oaks Animal Hospital. And I'm also joined by Jess. She's our videographer this morning. So feel free to add any questions or comments that you would like. And our topic this morning is keeping our furry friends safe in our home. And I thought this was really important as more and more of us are growing collections of houseplants in our home, but we're also sharing that space with cats and dogs and lizards and birds, all kinds of things. So we want to make sure that the things we bring into that environment are not only safe for ourselves, but also for our furry friends. So I have a few questions that I'd like to share with Dr. Mary Benz and see if we can get a little bit more insight on our furry friends and how they want to interact with plants. So, Mary Benz, I've got the question, first of all, why do pets like to chew on plants?
My pet answer is usually because they can, but a lot of times they're just investigating their environment. Some dogs and cats like to eat grass. Sometimes it's just a habit. Sometimes they have an upset stomach. But it's usually they're just investigating their environment and they don't know that something's bad for them. So.
Okay. So as we're kind of sharing our space with our pets, is there something that we can do to help deter or change that behavior? Because whether we have toxic plants in our home or whether we have non-toxic plants in our home, if we're going to spend the money on, you know, the beautiful cast iron plant or that kind of thing, we don't necessarily want to see teeth mark up and down the leaves, even though it's not toxic. So is there something we can do behavior modification wise to keep that behavior under control?
So with the really toxic plants, the best behavior modification is to just eliminate the plants from the environment, because you never want to take a chance that a dog or cat could eat something that could harm them. But there are a variety of other methods that you can use to keep them away, whether you're putting it up on a shelf from a dog or behind a door from a dog or a cat. There's also, if you're familiar with invisible fence, which is a form of electric fencing that a lot of people use outdoors, there is a system that you can use inside the house. It's basically like a little disc and it provides a perimeter that the pet won't enter. That's probably best used for dogs. Cats, while they supposedly could be trained to invisible fence, it's maybe less successful. But those are some of the simple things that you can do to try to keep them away. I think you had a couple of other suggestions.
Yeah. So one of the things that I've used, I've got two cats at home, and one is very timid, very shy. She doesn't investigate anything. But then I've got my Rosie, who is absolutely into anything, especially if it's something I'm interested in. She's usually right on top of it. And one of the things that I found that works really well, I sprinkle cayenne pepper on the soil of a new plant that I bring home. Causes her to sneeze, and for whatever reason, she doesn't really like to sneeze. So that's a really good deterrent. I sprinkle it on there the first time I introduce her to that plant. She sneezes, and then she avoids it afterwards. Jess actually likes to use for her hawk. This is actually a pigeon. What did you call this, Jess?
It's like a bird spike.
A bird spike. And it's kind of pointy. It's very light, very flexible. I've actually used this on my Rosie. I'll actually set it on the table right in front of a plant. And oftentimes, if she wants to hop up there to check something out, she'll bump into it, kind of pokes her. It usually falls off the table. She jumps off the table, and then it works pretty well. But yeah, the cayenne pepper works much better for Rose. But I think the one thing that I really want to try and focus on is, you know, when we're bringing plants or animals into our home, the key is really keeping an eye on their behavior, seeing what they're interested in, what they're, you know, what things they ignore, what things they're really focused on. Another thing that I've also used, not so much with the cats that I have now, but in the past, is just a fine mist of a spray bottle. I can do that as a sharp spray and just give somebody a shot in the rear end whenever they're looking at a plant or doing something that I don't want them to do. And it's kind of a nice shock, but yet I'm not right next to them so that they don't necessarily see me as creating that negative contact with them. But again, the idea is to really keep an eye on your pets and make sure that whatever we're bringing into that environment is safe for them, or if we can change that behavior. I know for my girls, whenever I am watering my plants, I notice there's a certain sound of the water absorbing into the soil. It's kind of that little crackle pop. They're usually right there whenever I'm watering. But I also notice a strong change in smell whenever that soil is wet. I love that smell, and I don't know if it's them being attracted to the sound or the smell. But again, that's one of the behaviors that I really try and keep an eye on to make sure that they can be curious and be present, but not necessarily in that space. So let's go on. Another question, does the size of a pet, you know, a Great Dane versus a Chihuahua, does that affect the impact on an animal's body if they do ingest something?
Well, that's a good, great question, but I would say generally while toxins are dose dependent on weight, plants are probably not as much as other things like say if a dog were to ingest a pill, you know, that was toxic, the weight is definitely important. So whether it be, for example, like a lily, which are very toxic, even one or two bites of a lily or chews on the plant can be very toxic to a cat, whether it's a kitten or an adult cat. So it's not generally breed dependent or weight dependent.
So. Okay. Yeah, and I think that's really significant that you'll see on our Facebook page connected with this event, there is an excellent website that Dr. Ben shared with us that you can go through, and it shows pictures of the plant and kind of labels whether or not it is toxic, whether it is safe. And actually the website goes into cats, dogs, and horses. So that's kind of interesting. I wish I had a horse, but I don't. But again, one of the things that's really critical is just checking and being aware of what you're bringing in your home. But check out that website. And you know, whenever you're buying plant material, we have a lot of customers that come in and buy plant material based on the way it looks or the way, you know, whether it's a high light or a low light. But this is another thing to take into consideration when you are purchasing those plants, is pull up that list. And I would love to see that as an app on my phone or something like that, that if I'm going to go plant shopping, make sure you identify that plant and check that website to just make sure whether or not that is a safe plant for your pet. And even if a plant is safe, as Dr. Benz was mentioning, something can still cause vomiting even though it is not toxic. Is that correct?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. So that's something to keep in mind. But again, not long ago, Dr. Benz had actually sent me a picture of a plant that one of her customers or one of her patients had chewed on. And just getting a confirmation of what is this plant, it did cause vomiting, but it wasn't toxic. So it was, you know, the cat was gonna be okay. But again, just to have that confirmation. And I know for myself, I've got a file in on my computer of all the plant material that I have in my house. So it's a great way not only to categorize the plant material that I have, care instructions, you know, whether it's a succulent or cactus or something that wants a lot of water, a little bit of water and sunlight, but have another category box on there as to whether or not, you know, what the response is going to be. If my Rosie decides to chew on something, is it going to cause her to vomit, but it's not toxic? That's something that we might want to add another category to our collection of houseplant information, just to make sure that we're keeping them safe. So another question I have is, what should we do if for whatever reason one of our cats or dogs comes into contact with something toxic? How should we respond in that event?
So the first thing I would do would be to remove the plant, to remove it so no further ingestion can occur. Then I would probably contact my veterinarian if the veterinarian was closed. There are 24-hour facilities in the area that you can call to see if the plant is toxic, and or Platt Hill is an excellent resource for plant identification, because I can't usually identify the plant. But also the ASPCA Poison Control website is an excellent resource. You can always call them directly, and they will provide information as if it's toxic and what you should be aware of. Be aware there is a fee to call them, although you can check out their website for a lot of great information. There is a fee to call them if there's been a toxin exposure, but they charge me that same fee if I call them, so I don't have a back door in to call them and say, hey, what is this? So there is a fee, but then they give you a case number and then allows us to call to see what treatment might be needed, especially if it's toxic. As far as, you know, should you induce vomiting, most plant toxicities, the first thing you're going to see is vomiting. I wouldn't probably start inducing vomiting unless you were told to. I would just work quickly to remove the plant and get more information as far as what might need to be done.
So I think another thing that might be critical too, when Dr. Benz had sent me that information, I assume the customer, or the, keep calling him a customer, that patient probably either brought in the plant or brought in a picture of that plant. So again, if you do have concerns about that toxicity, you see leaves being chewed up or that kind of thing, and then you have a sick cat or dog, and in hindsight, it might be important to take a picture of that plant, bring that plant when you are headed to the vet, just so that we can get a proper identification, because that might really affect the treatment of that pet. Again, if there's any questions that you have by any chance, but feel free to send those into Jess. One of the things I do want to touch base on that we have talked about in the past when we're talking about care of plants is if we are going to treat our plants with insecticide or other chemicals that will eliminate, you know, if you've got aphids or whitefly or something like that, you're going to want to make sure that you're mindful of that chemical that you're using on your plants. And as usual, I'm always a big proponent of make sure you're getting your hands in your plants, because oftentimes we can eliminate the need for those insecticides just by washing and keeping the cultural care, keeping the soil appropriately moist, making sure that your leaf surface is clean and dust free, and, you know, rinsing off that foliage occasionally is really a great idea that we can use to eliminate that need for insecticide or miticide, so that we don't have to incorporate that in the care of our houseplants. Question?
Do we have the phone number for the ASPCA Poison Control Center? Can we have it available?
I believe you do. Mary's got that.
So the phone number for the ASPCA is 888-426-4435. That's 888-426-4435. It's an excellent number to have on hand if you have a pet for any possible toxic, not only plants, but medications or anything.
Chocolate,
yeah.
All right. So one of the things I'd kind of like to do at this point in time too, since I kind of brought up the topic of insects, there's some other things that we can do to help not only keep our plants insect free, but also that these things will not affect our cats or our dogs. So if we're struggling, especially in these winter months, either with fungus gnats or whitefly, using a thin coating of fine sand on the top of our soil will keep those adults from burrowing in the soil and laying eggs. That also keeps the larva from coming up from down below. So again, that sprinkling of fine sand over the top of our soil. And also in the winter months, when most of our houseplants are in a dormant period, we can back off on that watering, because those insects like to have a moist soil in which to lay their eggs. So if we can back off on watering and cover that soil surface with sand, a fine sand, that will really help to deter any insect happening. And again, keeping our foliage clean is always a good idea. Spider mites really like to have that dusty surface, and as well as if we're keeping our foliage rinsed, that's also going to help with aphids and a lot of other issues that might prey upon our plants during those winter months. All right, I would like to take a few minutes just to kind of go through some plant material that you might be looking at in your home. Some of the things that are safe lower light plants, ferns are an excellent option. This here is the rabbit foot fern. You can check out those furry feet, but the rabbit fern is a pet safe plant. And one of the things that's a challenge, I know for my little Rosie at home, is she loves things that move. So a lot of these are going to have moving foliage. So again, a little bit of behavior modification or correction might really help. Also in that fern family, which is a very different kind of plant, this is the staghorn fern. Does a really nice job also in a high moisture content area with low light. And again, this is also a pet safe plant. But teeth marks up and down the side, probably not so cute any longer. So again, keep an eye on your pets. Make sure you know what they're chewing on. This is another one that is a low light plant. This is the cast iron plant. This is actually a variegated cast iron plant. Again, a nice low light pet safe plant. Beautiful variegation in the leaf. This one is quite the slow grower, so you really have to be patient. If you want something large and flush, it's gonna take you a while to get there, but a beautiful plant. And as far as blooming plants go, you can see this Phalaenopsis orchid. Beautiful plant. The orchid is a pet safe plant. Other bloomers that are pet safe in lower light, the African violet, which I unfortunately don't have any at this time, but the African violet is also a pet safe low light plant. So if we're moving up the light category, onto things that are a little bit more moderate sunlight, here we have the prayer plant or the Maranta. This is in that Calathea family, which is all a pet safe family. These are beautiful in low light. They've got the nice variegation to the leaf. Also, you see that nice purple peak from the back. Again, a nice plant for that lower to mid light kind of range. In the back, you'll see we have this beautiful palm. This is an areca palm. The areca palm actually is a great, not only pet safe, moderate amount of sunlight, but it's also a nice air purification plant. Excellent choice for the home office or the home space, just to raise that and improve that air quality. Somebody else that's a moderate light, this is the goldfish plant. This is a nice cute little trailer that has nice little orange colored flowers to it. This will be a nice plant for kind of that hanging space in a moderately lit area. Again, pet safe, goldfish plant. This next one is the Peperomia family. This is one variety of the Peperomia. Peperomia is a pet safe plant. A lot of range of color and variety in the Peperomia. This is a beautiful, almost succulent-like leaf. This can take, again, that moderate amount of sunlight to a little bit of highlight. And as we're transitioning seasons in the winter months, realize that that sunlight isn't quite as intense as it is in the summer months. So you might have this in a west or south window at this point in time, but that might be a little too much sun once we get into those summer months. So you'll want to keep an eye on your foliage to make sure that you're not getting any burning or scalding. Another perfect trooper for not only pet safe, but clean air. This is the good old spider plant. This baby is not only a clean air plant, pet safe plant, but it is tried and true. And it will cast off pups, and you can be able to easily propagate and continue to grow that on and on. A great trailing plant. Also a really nice plant because of its bright foliage. It kind of raises light, raises color in a little bit darker space. Question.
Somebody asked if we can have a list posted of the plants we're talking about. We can add that to the description after the video.
Yeah, we can add a list of the plants that I've kind of got here on display. But again, I would also refer you back to that link that is connected to this video. I spent some time going through that the last couple days and really kind of raised my awareness of plants, not only for indoor houseplants, but also things that are outdoor, the annuals, trees, and shrubs. There's so much information on that. It's an excellent resource. But yes, we will definitely share the list of plants that I'm sharing with you today. All right, let's move on. Another fern that is a wonderful plant. This is the asparagus fern. This does a really nice job, not only as an indoor house plant, but also a lot of people will actually take this outside and use it in their summer containers because it has such a nice free-flowing feel to it. It's nice and airy, but again, excellent for not only plant safe, but indoor and outdoor usage. Also, this time of year, a lot of people are looking for that lucky bamboo. Lucky bamboo is also on the pet safe list. This is a really nice plant that likes a high moisture area, so great for bathrooms, something that's got that higher level of humidity. It can take a moderate amount of sunlight, but again, high levels of humidity, it will be the happiest. All right, so we're kind of moving into more highlight, or before we go there, this is the bromeliad. Also, it is in kind of a relative to the tillandsia or air plants. They are also pet safe and just kind of a fun add of texture. I've got a few tillandsias that I kind of wanted to show. It's always fun to find cute ways to display our tillandsias, but these are air plants and they do really well also in a high moisture content area, so the bathroom or that kind of thing. These are very easy to care for. They can either be misted once or twice a week, or they can also be soaked. But the key is after soaking or after misting, we want to make sure that we invert them so that the water flows out of the crown of the plant. A lot of folks who either dip or mist keep them upright and end up rotting out that core of the plant. So again, air plants, pet safe, awesome opportunity for a high moisture area. All right, let's head back to the cart and look at, this is a ponytail palm. This ponytail palm actually can also take a little bit of higher light. One of the things we need to be mindful of in the winter months is the air content in our house is usually so dry. A lot of times when you have these fine foliage plants, you'll get a little bit of brown tipping. That's often a sign of low humidity. So again, putting them in a higher humidity area, or make sure that you're misting that foliage to keep that humidity level up. Another option is to put a pan of water with stones underneath, just so that that water evaporates up into the canopy of the plant. The last few that I want to mention in the safe pet category, these are Hoya. There's tons of different variety of Hoya that are available. Hoya is a succulent, so this is going to be a higher light plant. A lot of the plants that are in that succulent category, we want to make sure that we water thoroughly, but then let them dry out fully. We want to make sure that when we're watering to the point where water comes out the base of the pot, but then also we let them dry out fully so that we don't rot out that root system. Another one that's really fun is the Hindu rope. That is another type of Hoya that has kind of a curled, gnarly look to it. Unfortunately, I don't have any of those to show you, but the Hoya has a lot of different variety and they are pet safe. Another fun succulent family, this is the Horwathia, and it has a nice, tight, compact growth, lots of different variety and texture. They do an excellent job in either a mixed container or as just a single plant in a pot. Again, they are a little bit slow of a grower, but you can see he's working on a flower here, so it's a very unique kind of plant that does a wonderful job in high light scenario, and again, pet safe. Yes, a question.
So just to reinstate that the plants that we were just talking about, these ones that were more of the high light loving plants,
yes,
right?
Yes. So in our high light category are the Hoya, the Horwathia, as well as, let me show you these ones. These are super cute. This is the Echeveria family. The Echeveria family has a ton of different options available, but it is that tight, low-growing succulent that is very cute to enhance any kind of a succulent or cactus garden. Do well planted together. And whenever you're watering these, one of the things that's critical is to make sure you're watering the perimeter of the plant, not down over the crown. We want to make sure that we are watering the roots and not through that crown of the plant. All right, the other one that I wanted to mention, you can see right back here, this is our parlor palm, otherwise known as the Nethbella palm. It is another excellent plant for that moderate to high light, and again, pet friendly. So those are the plants that I kind of wanted to share with you today. And by all means, if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to Platt Hill Nursery or to your veterinarian to make sure that the environment you're creating for your furry friends will be safe and enjoyable for you all. Thanks for checking in with us, and thank you to Dr. Benz for joining us this morning.
Thank you very much.
And again, we look forward to working with you and not only finding plants that will enhance your environment, but also your furry friends as well. Have a great day.